When the moon hits your eye like a big pizza pie, that's amore.
You're listening to Lombard Trucking.
When the world seems to shine like you've had too much wine.
What's going on, everyone? Welcome back to episode 70 of the Lombard Trucking Show. Can you believe it? 70 episodes. I'm pumped. Probably not as special as 69. I'd say 69 was the real mile marker I'm going to. So, which means now we got to make it all the way to 420, or else then what the hell did I even get into this for? But no delays on this one. I was texted very suddenly, very briefly to get this episode recorded. So if you couldn't tell by my outfit, this is actually exactly what I wore when I was talking to Blythe, because at time of recording, I actually did it right after I spoke with Blythe. But and so we timed this a little bit before 69 because I had to get the story down. Because if you're watching, not listening, you can see I have two guests with me. One of them is my very good friend, Chris, a.k.a. the Indie Trucker. You can find him everywhere, especially Twitter, as Indie Trucker. He is actively engaged on freight Twitter. You can follow his whole life over the road. He has an interesting one. He's got an old school truck. He could run Outlaw if he wanted to, but he chooses not to. He's got the ELD, a beautiful long nose Freightliner. But he told me he has a gentleman. He said you got to get his story because he has seen both sides of the page, from pre deregulation of trucking into afterwards, into becoming an owner operator. And he just has, some fantastic stories. So without any further delay, I'd like to welcome Dave to the show. Dave, thanks for being here.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Hell yeah, man. So you've had an interesting story. As Chris has told me, we kind of engaged with it offline. He was shooting me some text about it. So yeah, what is your story? Where'd you start? How'd you get started, man?
Well, actually didn't really think I was going to be a trucker. I was a mechanic at the time, not a very good one. And I met a girl, and her father worked for Consolidated Freightways. Well, at that time, he didn't want it. There was a stigma between, because he was an old school guy, had been at CF for, almost 40 years at that time. And he didn't want the stigma of a son-in-law working with him at that time. So he got me hooked up with a company called Motor Cargo, and I started working the freight docks, go in at midnight, get off at 10 o'clock in the morning, lumping freight. And that's back when it wasn't palletized. There was one forklift for the entire dock, and you put everything on a cart and pulled it out, put it on a pallet, and then somebody, you'd haul for a tow motor and they'd come pick it up and load it into a route trailer.
What year is this?
This was 1991.
Awesome.
And I wanted to learn how to drive. Well, Ray didn't want to teach me, and that was my father-in-law at the time. But his brother worked for Motor Cargo, so he taught me how to drive. And I learned in a 1978 cab over Freightliner with a 10-speed. And he would crawl in the back. He'd be hung over. And every time I'd miss a gear or do something stupid, I'd get, slapped to the back of the head, and, this is how you do it. So then, and then from there, it just, it was kind of one thing after another. I got my CDL, went down, took the test, took the, used their equipment and stuff. And I wanted more. I wanted, I was only, like I said, I was making $8.72 an hour back then, which back then, not bad money. But the wife and I wanted a family, and there was no way to do that on just $8.72 working the dock. So I needed to be a driver. So I got my CDL, and there was an opening at a company called Nations Way Trucking. They're no longer in business. And they were Teamsters. Motor Cargo was a team, but they were under what they call a sweetheart contract. So you got part of, you only got like 85% of what the National Master Freight Agreement was at the time. No retirement. And the benefits were okay. But Nations Way, they were full-blown National Master Freight. So you actually, you got paid big money. Well, I went over, applied to be a casual at the time. And it was just, you know, you come in, work the dock, you know, you work 4 hours, you're on call 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And if you refused to come in, that was your last day. You never got, they would never call you again. And back then, you had to fight for, you know, you had to show up, you had to be there, you had to, you know, and you had to perform and perform well. Well, it started slowing down in the freight, and they wanted me to run line. Well, I'd never driven over the mountain before, and it was, you know, coming from Reno, going over Donner Pass. Well, you know, they threw me the keys, handed me a trip pack, and said, you need to go to Hayward. Well, trucks didn't have jig brakes. I had no clue what I was doing. So let's just say we smoked them all the way to Auburn. And then, you know, from then on, from 1992, I drove line up until the point where I called in one day and said, hey, you know, I didn't, you know, I was on a call block. So you had to call in at midnight, and between midnight and two, that was your call. You had a 2 hour call block. So I called in to see, I was waiting for the call. Nothing came in. So about 2 a.m. I called him up. I said, hey, I said, I'd like to, what's going on? You no runs for me. And they're like, oh, we can't use you anymore. And I went, what? What are you guys talking about? Well, back then in the contract, and this is all Teamster stuff, if you worked a certain amount of trips, once you got to that 31st trip of, you know, consecutive trips, you were force hired. So they would have to put you on the seniority roster, put you on the board, pay you the benefits and all of that stuff. Whereas a casual, all you had to work like 80 hours a month or something like that. And then you would get like partial benefits from them. So if they didn't have to put me on, you know, because once I went on the board, I would get all those benefits. So I called them up the next day. I was like, hey, you know, what's going on? They're like, yeah, you're going to have to go find something else. So I went to Willig Freight Lines. Willig is no longer in business either. So there's a run here. Motor Cargo's not in business. Nation's Way not in business. Willig Freight Lines is no longer in business.
Well, these are all Teamster companies.
And they're all Teamster companies.
Yeah, this is how it gets dropped, because this is kind of what happened to my family's company. Lombard was, you know, it was purchased in 84. You know, the company sold by North Penn Transfer, which is out of Lansdale, Pennsylvania. I also have a hat of theirs. We were talking yesterday. I have a consolidated, a CF hat as well. And North Penn Transfer, they ended up folding in 92 due to union contract negotiations.
Yep.
And I'm assuming a lot of these companies were faced with the same thing. They could, like, that's the thing. Yep. That company probably would have hired you, and like, you could have joined the union, but they just couldn't afford it.
Oh, right. Yeah. Well, the thing was, I had already went down and requested to join the union, and they waived my initiation, which I thought was, you know, that was great, but I'm still paying dues. So, you know, I went to the shop steward. Shop steward's like, well, no, sorry, there's nothing we can do for you. And I'm like, well, okay, move on to the next one. So I went to Willig, went in, talked with the guy. I mean, when I went talk to that terminal manager at Nation's Way, my next trip was over to Willig, talked with that terminal manager. He asked me, he goes, you got gloves in your truck? And I said, well, yeah, I do. And he goes, well, get your gloves. He goes, they're going to give you a delivery route and you're hired. What? No drug test, no physical, just you're hired. You know, they put me on and I started waiting. It was a fantastic company. Fantastic company. I loved it. If they were still in business, I'd probably still be there.
This is LTL freight, right?
LTL, and their claim to fame, they have the bright yellow and blue with the big yellow smiley face on the back of their trucks. That was Willig's thing. And their claim to fame was next day before noon was their, you know, their LTL stuff.
Oh, so they were like the Prime, the Amazon Prime of their day.
Exactly. And trust me, none of their trucks were governed. Everything hauled the mail. And I scared myself a few times because I'm still a fresh, you know, young driver. You know, I had no clue. I had no clue what a freaking 18 speed was at that time. But I had to learn it. You know, and driving an old cab over Peterbilt at that time. You know, hauling line. But yeah, I mean, we'd get into convoys of, you know, 30, 40 trucks, everybody talking on the radio. That doesn't happen today. Somebody up front had a bird dog and, you know, would just holler out, hey, contact. And, you know, everybody slow down because we're going through California. And of course, you know, the People's Republic, you have to do 55, guess stay alive. So we had a meeting. The CEO and the CFO showed up. The guy's name was John Fredonia, and he fit the freaking bill of a Fredonia. He came in, basically told us, you either effing vote for this pay reduction or we'll close the goddamn doors. And everybody at that meeting basically told him, we'll call your bluff. Do it. 3 weeks later, Willick Freight Lines went out of business.
Damn.
Yeah. So I went and applied over at Roadway. And Consolidated Freightways. ABF was like a two-man terminal at that time here in Reno. And then I went and talked with them too, but they were like, we're not hiring. You know, they were working out of the old Reno Freight Yard, which was just, I mean, it was basically a homeless encampment at the time. So I went to Roadway, went to CF. CF called me 2 hours before Roadway did. So I went to CF, started working there as a casual. And at that time they had what they called a mixed board. There was, I think there was 199 guys on the board at the time. And I was basically, you had to start from scratch. So you were a 4 hour casual, you worked the dock, you had to prove your worth. And then they would, you know, if they wanted to hire somebody, you basically had to outshine everybody to do it. So I went on the board. I was number 198. And when they went out of business, I was number 9 on the board.
Holy shit.
There was a lot of old guys there. There was a lot of old guys there. And
got their whole careers. They probably have pensions, I imagine.
They had pensions. They had their entire careers there, you know. And that was my plan. You know, we started a family when I was there at CF and had our first kid there. Teamsters, I mean, the benefits were just fabulous, you know. September, well, Labor Day 2002, the wife and I and my two kids at that time, and we had a new home. Had bought, you know, like 2 years before, and we had went on vacation for Labor Day weekend, you know, went camping, went out in the woods and, you know, just had a blast. Came home, and this is back before voicemail, had an answering machine.
Oh, well, yeah. Old tape.
Yep. So I'm unloading everything. She's got the kids in the house, and she sees that the machine's flashing. Well, it's a recorded message from Consolidated Freightways telling me to call an 800 number. So she says, hey, there's a message on there from CF, you know, calling this to call this 800 number. I was like, well, just call it, you know, see what it is. She comes back out in tears. There was 15,500 of us lost our jobs that day. And then, you know, mad scramble, you know, now you're, you know, what do you want to do? And, you know, now I've got so many years invested in it that it's kind of pissed me off. You know, I'm thinking to myself, you know, I don't want to keep doing this bullshit is kind of what I was thinking, you know. But that's what I was good at. And that's what I knew. So I went to work for multiple, I mean, I was working for Gippo places, you know, there was a company, well, they helped me out, ITS Logistics. They're a small little 3PL here. I was their first driver, you know, and basically I would just outlaw shit. They'd say, hey, we need you in Vegas, you know, and, you know, pick this crate up from this convention center and get it back here as fast as you can. So I'd go down and turn Davis, you know, and from Reno, you know, that's 1,000 freaking miles round trip.
Damn it, that's a haul.
That's a haul, you know, and just, you know, keep my foot on the floor and go, you know, and go do it and make some money and stuff like that. But I went to work for, I started casualing for ABF at the time. And they were, you know, the whole market was absolutely horrible at that time. So they weren't looking to put anybody on. And I had applied at Yellow. I had applied at Roadway. Nobody had called. I mean, my phone was freaking silent. And I, you know, here I am. You know, I can do local P&D. I can do line haul. You know, doesn't matter. I can do it. No phone calls. And I was like, oh, shit. You know, so Conway. Let's talk about Conway. I thought to myself, well, I got to find a deal. Well, Conway back in the day, when they opened Conway, that was kind of a slap into the face of Consolidated Freightways because CF owned them. That was their non-union carrier. And we lost quite a bit of stuff to them. We lost contracts to them and stuff. And they're like, oh, they're not competing with us. Well, they're the same thing. They're both LTL carriers. They're the same damn thing. Well, we started continually losing freight, you know, and back then, you know, CF just did a lot of dumb freaking things. You know, I don't know if you remember Emery Air Freight. They started their own, like, trying to compete with FedEx and UPS. They bought airplanes. LTL companies shouldn't be buying freaking airplanes, but they did. And they lost their ass on it. So, yeah, they just did a lot of stuff. But I ended up working for Conway for about 6 months until there was an opening at Yellow. Went over to Yellow. Conway was a terrible job. That was one of the most awful freaking LTL jobs I've ever had. Basically, you start 7 o'clock at night, you load your own freight, hook your set, drive to Sacramento, put your set to the dock, unload your freight, go find your freight out of everybody else's shit, reload your freaking trailers, hook your set, take it back over the hill, break your set up, put it to the dock, unload your freight. And they wanted that done in 12 hours. Good God. And it was for not a lot of money. And they would just work it to freaking death. So, and I think, well, Conway is now XPO.
Really?
Yep. And I think that's the same model that they're running under. Yeah, those guys, they get worked to death.
They just some of those jobs, and they're very predatory in their recruiting because that's how the beverage places are, like Coke and Pepsi. They're the same way, like, oh, you know, your shifts are only this long, home every night, blah, blah, blah. But everything, you know, you're doing all the loading and unloading, and you're for what the work is, you're putting in is fucking trash. Yeah.
Exactly. And so by the time I got the call from Yellow to come to work, because I'm trying to get on with Roadway too. You know, everybody that was, you know, basically below me on the board when I was at Consolidated Freightways was now had more seniority than me. So, but, you know, it is what it is. You know, you just got to keep plugging away. Because at that time, I'm the only income in my house. My wife's a stay-at-home mom raising our kids. You know, I got a mortgage and, you know, there's no quit. You know, you got to do it. And I would also, you know, on the weekends, I'd run for ITS, you know, or if, you know, they had, you know, extra, you know, if they had extra like line haul stuff at Yellow or whatever, I'm on it. Let's do it. You know, I don't care if it's 7 days a week. I didn't have, you know, at the end of the day, it was paper logs back in those days. You know, you turn your paper logs in and tear the rest up. And if it wasn't a good day, you know, man, there's always a new page. So, you know, I learned a lot of that. And then 2009, they did the final Roadway Yellow merger into that YRC, what it is now.
I was going to say, they're all kind of together now, like Roadway, Yellow,
Redway.
Redway, yeah.
Yeah. USF Freightways, yeah. They're all one. And when they did the merger and they closed the one terminal, we all moved over to the other terminal. You know, it was all supposed to be happy and go lucky. And I worked 2 weeks and got laid off again. And at that time, I had 17 years going in this. And I was done with LTL. I was unhappy. I was an angry freaking guy. Because, you know, I called, you know, at that time, you know, hell, at CF, I was a shop steward. And, you know, and I would try, you know, I'd go in and negotiate guys that came in drunk to freaking work and save their damn job. But the first time I went to the freaking union, the only time I went to the union, hey, what can you do for me? Not a thing. There was nothing they could do. So,
You cut out on me real quick.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry.
Are we back?
Yeah, no, you're good. So, yeah, you're back. You blacked out for a little bit. I'll edit this little blip out. So, last thing you said.
Hold on just 1 second. I want to do something. Okay.
Are we still there?
Yeah.
Okay. I just put it on do not disturb, so no more phone calls. Hopefully.
All right, sweet. Yeah, literally. So you went to the last thing you said. Oh, flip the screen again. There we go.
Technology.
So just be like the last thing you said, because I'll cut it there. Is I went to the union, and they could do nothing for me.
Yeah, they couldn't do the union couldn't do anything for me, and so I was just frustrated trying to find something. I had mortgage payment coming up, you know, I had car payment, stuff like that, and I went on to Craigslist, and there was an advertisement for, hey, we're going to guarantee you $1,000 a week, you know, to run, you know, ammunition and explosives. I'm like, well, shit, that sounds like a good deal. You know, I gave them a call. They, you know, said, hey, you know, we'll fly you in to, you know, to Phoenix. We'll do our orientation. We'll get your background check and all this other stuff. And that's where I met.
Yep. That's where he met me, and same story. I found the same job on Craigslist. You know, that kind of funny era there, the internet, where Craigslist was really the happening place. Like, Craigslist was probably the monster indeed of the time, you know, that time. Like, you know, just text up on there, and I think I even found Autumn through Craigslist, where I'm at currently. So, yeah, Craigslist was a big thing, you know, a lot of jobs were posted there. There was big recruiting in Craigslist at that time.
And this is 2009?
2009, yeah.
Yep.
And similar, you know, that's how I got there. Like, trucking market in 2009, we were coming through the Great Recession. There were so many closures and, you know, changes, slowdown. I was at FedEx Custom Critical, and, you know, the freight had went from being really good to being just setting slow all the time. And wasn't doing a whole lot, so had to change something up at that time.
So, yeah, hauling DOD freight. That's a different type of. You definitely need to be married to somebody to do that.
Yeah.
You know, they put me with some dude that lived out of Dayton. His name was Carl, and Carl was not the cleanest guy in the world, and wasn't the greatest driver either. You know, he'd like to practice things, and I would just do stop freaking doing that and just let's go. You know, you don't need to practice backing in. You know, you got your freaking CDL. Let's go do it. If you need help, I'll get out and, you know, we'll go do it. But yeah, that little love affair with Carl didn't work out all that well. So, one of the guys I had worked with at Yellow, I call him a brother from another mother. I called him up. I said, hey, you know, and he's like, yeah, he goes, I'm laid off. And, you know, I said, you want to go team with me? So we did. And we worked basically the next 6 months running DOD stuff. Sometimes some weeks were really good. We made some money. And other weeks, you know, you'd sit for a week and a half at a freaking truck stop waiting on, you know, the government to like, oh, you know, because their whole idea was position the truck, put the truck into position. That way, when the call's there, we can just snatch it up and go get it. Well, I love the guy to death, but I didn't want to freaking live with him for a week in a freaking truck stop, dude. You know, and we're living in a white Volvo, you know. It was like, no. So the straw that broke the camel's back on that one, we had done a bunch of hazardous waste loads in California. And we get our settlement, and we both got $45 settlements. And we were like, what the hell? So we called them up, and they're like, well, you guys weren't available on this day, and you weren't available on this day. And we're like, we've been running this whole freaking time. We, you know, you can go back and look at our freaking logs. You know, we've made all the deliveries and all the pickups. Well, we're not going to argue with you, and that's your settlement. And I was like, well, fine. Come get your goddamn truck. And that was the end of them. I dropped their truck. I emptied everything I could out of it, put it at the Alamo truck stop, dropped the keys in a trip pack, and said, kiss my ass. Good luck.
So, oh, man.
Same thing. Like, I think we lasted even less than you. Like, yep. 3 months. We're there 3 months, and that's what drove me into buying my own truck and trying to go back to FedEx. And, yeah, that was a horrible company. They got bought out. They got sold several times. I think Tri-State owns them now. You know, kind of the consolidation of ammo haulers there that occurred during the last decade. So they got bought out.
Yeah, I'm wondering how much Justin from Freight Waves might know about this. We'll have to hopefully get with him offline because he did that for a little while.
Sure. Yeah, he'd know a little bit about SLT. This is back when SLT would have been in their, like I said, white trucks, Internationals, Volvos, red lettering. You know, this is before they come out with the silver trucks with purple lettering, and they went through several changes. I think probably ownership changed several times, you know, between groups and stuff like that. But, yeah, that's how we met, and yeah, we've been connected at the hip ever since.
Yeah, so this is where the storylines cross. 2009, yeah. You guys meet, and then but then eventually you separate again. So what happens from there?
Well, my brother Cal had a buddy that was working for Sherwin Williams Paint, and he called him up. You know, we were just, you know, we were desperate, and he called. He goes, what do you think? And I'm like, call him up. So he called him up, and they were looking for a team. And so we went up, we interviewed, we got the job, and we started teaming for basically it's CTS National is what it is. Or not national, CTS Sherwin Williams. So they have a company side, and then they have an owner operator side, and that's later in the story. But we started teaming, and man, what a difference! I mean, that they're an actual damn good company to work for. They really are. They really do treat their drivers pretty damn well. The hard part of that whole deal is store deliveries. Because you're actually delivering paint to the stores, you know, pallet jack to the back of the trailer, store comes out with the forklift, but it's getting into a strip mall, you know, with the 48 footer and a, you know, great big Cascadia, you know, so that's the only part I didn't really care for, you know, of that whole deal. But, you know, I'm kind of going back to that, but I'm going to Walmart. I mean, it's, you know, that's going to be easy compared to what I was dealing with there at Sherwin. But no, we ran team for a while. He got his wife involved, and they became a team. So I became just went to a single man, and, you know, working for, you know, CF and Yellow and all that stuff, I had a bunch of double and triple experience. Well, they would run basically what they call A trains out of Reno here to like Salt Lake City, or we'd run Rocky Mountain doubles into Wyoming and Montana and Idaho. And that's a 48 with a 28 hook behind it, and go deliver paint that way. And if I went to Salt Lake or down to Vegas, I would pull 245s. And, you know, 129 feet long and, you know, 130,000 pounds of paint. So, you know, it just, you know, I had a bunch of long combination experience. So they wanted me to do that. They said, I had just a bitching run, man, just a bitching run. I would run a set. I'd leave Sunday, go deliver Monday with the set in Salt Lake City. I'd have 14, 15 store deliveries, go make deliveries. If they had like a pallet trailer or they needed me to go pick up salt or whatever as a backhaul, I'd go do that, hook my set, be back. And then my next load was a set of doubles down to Vegas and just, you know, just back and forth. I was I made like 102, 103,000 bucks, you know, every year doing that. And it was fantastic. And then all of a sudden management just changed things. And they started a real big mass hiring there. Well, then it got to the point where they would split my load up. Well, when I was pulling doubles, I made more money. Well, I'm doing twice the work. That just makes sense. But if I'm hauling a single trailer, then I'm back at single man rate. So, and it was still, you know, oh, we're just going to have you do the Salt Lake stores, you know, and I'd go do 2-3 deliveries, make, you know, and come back. Well, now my mileage is way down. You know, it's, you know, I'm not making the same per mile, but, you know, it's the same mileage, but, you know, now it's way down. And then, you know, oh, you know, to supplement it, they're like, oh, we need you to go over to the Bay Area and deliver stores. Oh, man, that's like a sharp stick in the eye. It just, it was like, are you kidding me? And then it just kept getting progressively worse and worse and worse. And then they were like, oh, do you want to run Alberta for us? Absolutely. I'll go run Alberta. That lasted 2 weeks. And then they were like, nope, we're going to put somebody else on it. And it was like, it kept building up to the point. And I called him up. I said, hey, here's what I'm thinking about doing.
Yeah.
And he's like, Dave, you know, you got a pretty good gig there. Don't do it. And I just did not listen. And so I bought a truck and I actually went to work for Sherman Williams as an owner operator.
Hmm.
Back then, I think it was $1.17 a mile and plus fuel surcharge. And they would just, you know, they would basically, you would run 3,000 to 4,000 miles a week. You know, you're basically swinging doors, you're bumping docks, you're not delivering anything. You know, it was pretty good, but there was always that, you know, now I've got a truck payment, I got fuel. I've got, you know, I had to, you know, thank God my wife was, you know, she finally got a job, but she was working for the school district at the time. So I had insurance covered, you know, because that was a big deal. You know, what am I going to do if, you know, kids get sick or whatever? Well, you know, I would talk to him and I talked to other buddies that I had met over the years, and they're like, well, you know, we're making this and we're making that and we're making this. And the grass was always greener. And
Oh yeah. Somebody's always making more. Somebody's always making more. And there's always running more miles. There's always the one more guys.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Well, and I was hungry for that. So I left Sherman Williams as an owner op and I hired on at Autumn. The main problem with Autumn was they couldn't get me home.
Yeah,
I live in like the dead zone.
And it ends up being a recurring theme with every carrier you've leased on with. It's the West Coast.
Yes.
It's the West Coast plague. I mean,
it's the West Coast.
If you live out here, there's just, you know, everything's locked up out here.
You know, and I worked for Autumn, pulled pneumatic, did pretty well.
Did phenomenal.
You know, I reconnected with some family members back in Virginia, and I was able to park on their land. And then I would drive, you know, from Galax, Virginia. I would rent a car, drive to the airport there in Charlotte, get on a plane and fly home. And that was my home time.
Yeah.
Because there was no getting me to the West Coast. There just didn't happen.
Yeah. West 35 is kind of a graveyard.
It really is. It really is. And then they have a liquid division, and they said, oh, yeah, we can get you home. No problem. Okay, we'll, you know, bam, bam, you know, thank you, ma'am. We'll get you going. Well, the money wasn't the same as pneumatics, not even close. But they did get me home, you know, which was, you know, but it wasn't on a regular basis. You know, I'd go out and I'd work 2-3 months and then come home for a week and then go out and work 2-3 months. Well, being away from your you know, your family for that long sucks. It just sucks. And I'm a family guy. I'm tight with my kids. I'm tight with my wife. You know, we've been married now. You know, we're going on 31 years this year. So it's I was like, nope, this is just not working. I'm not making enough money. And then I heard the chiming bell or the sound of an oil rig. And I thought, man, I'm going to go make a fortune in the oil field. Well, I bought a blower for the truck, went out there, and I did pretty good for about 3 to 4 months. And then all of a sudden, ghost town.
Yeah.
Just a ghost town. It was booming, and then ghost town. And I'm like, shit.
I'm pretty sure that carrier is completely defunct and gone now.
I think so.
Oh, a lot of that. They're like, yeah. Some of that oil field stuff they're like the sirens of the sea. They've called a lot of people in because there's people on Facebook a lot, especially in some of these Texas trucking groups. They all want to lure you in. They're like, they tell you about the money. They show you what they're making. But the thing is, it's very hot and cold. This happened up in North Dakota, you know, a few years ago. People were lured in. They built whole towns in North Dakota that are now ghost towns. I mean, you know, it's like everybody like comes and goes. It's a real thing. It's like, and they lure you in and they build all these apartments. Then all of a sudden.
Oh, yeah. And I, you know, for, like I said, there was about 3 months there. My average to the truck was a little over $11,000 a week. That's damn good money. You know,
he wasn't putting any miles on the truck.
And I wasn't putting any miles, but the miles I did put on it were hard miles, man.
Yeah, them heavy.
Those lease roads though, and in rocks, Texas and Mexico. Oh yeah, you know, and especially if it rained. Oh yeah, I've been pulled out by a bunch of freaking bulldozers. You know, but then December of that year, my dad called me up. Lost my mom. And it was slow. I wasn't working all that much. I was, you know, and I was gone for, you know, three, four months at a time from the house. So it was even worse, but if you're making money, you can justify that to yourself that it's, you know, hey, this is for the future and blah, blah, blah. You know, I can take a month off and do this. Well, it never works out that way. And then, you know, you're just beating the snot out of your freaking equipment. So now I got a bunch of, you know, a bunch of maintenance issues to take care of. Lost my mom that December, and that was 18. And went to work for long haul trucking. Good organization. Damn good organization. The only problem with long haul, there's a lot of overhead. You have a lot of overhead. You can make great money if you live in Tennessee and Kentucky and Ohio. I live in freaking Reno, Nevada, you know? So I started looking for property in Tennessee. You know, hey, we're just going to pick up. We're going to move. And, you know, my wife's been here her whole life. And, you know, I moved from Tucson up to here. And, you know, and I was like, no, we're just, you know, we're going to do something different. COVID hit. That was just a really weird time. And now both my kids had moved out of the house by that time. And my wife's by herself. You know, I'm out, you know, Super Trucker Dave, you know, not, you know, and not home. And you know, like I said, we've been together 30 years. So there's a lot of things that I've had to just like, nope, I'm not doing it. I'm going to reel that in and I'm going to change things. So I went from long haul. I went back to CTS National because they have a plant here. They had a plant here in Reno. Well, then we got a wild hare in 2020 because I looked at Zillow and saw what my house was worth. And I went, holy shit, I can get that much?
Oh, yeah.
So we made this plan. I bought 40 acres in Lake Havasu City, Arizona.
Nice.
And
love it there. We were just down there.
It is. It is. But not in July. I'm just going to tell you that right now. So we sold, we moved down there, and it's the same old story, you know. But at that time, CTS didn't have a lane down there. There was no lane for me to run at all. And there was no way I was getting a deadhead back, you know, back and forth up to Reno for, I think at that time they were $1.35 a mile plus fuel surcharge, which is, you know, people just go, oh, Jesus, I can't freaking move my truck for that, you know. And you used to hear that all the time in truck stops, you know. Oh, I moved my truck for less than $4 a mile. Well, then you don't move all that much. You know, and so I went to Mercer. Fabulous company. Just an absolute, I have nothing bad to say about Mercer. Mercer's a damn good company. I started flatbedding again. I enjoy that. I enjoy the physicality of the job. That's the only thing with with what I'm going to be doing, I have to stay mindful of my physical, of my physical self, you know. Mentally, I'm pretty good, but dude, I don't want to be that freaking, that guy with freaking cankles. I'm just not going to be that guy. So, you know, Mercer was good. Then freight really started falling off this last year. I mean, just really started falling off. And then, you know, at the time, you know, man, I was making banging money with Mercer. I was gone a lot still. And that's a recurring thing. My wife comes up in June of last year and she calls me up and I said, hey, what's going on? You know, how's the grand? We just had a grandbaby too. And I said, how's the grandson and all that? And she goes, oh, they're great. She goes, I got some news for you. And I said, what? She goes, I'm not going back to Arizona. And I went, what do you mean? I'm not going back to Arizona. She goes, I'm not going back to Arizona. She goes, I'm down there by myself. She goes, it's hot as balls. And she goes, no, I'm just not going back. She goes, we're moving back to Reno. I said, well, okay. So I put the property up for sale. It sold. Moved back up here. I bought 10 acres out in a little town called Silver Springs, Nevada. And we're going to build the home where I die at. So Mercer wasn't really working out. I'm trying to find something where I can keep my truck, get back into the house, make at least, you know, I'm trying to figure out revenue numbers and stuff like that. And while I was at Mercer, you know, I lost the motor in my truck. Had to have an in-frame. In the week before that, lost the turbo and the actuator. So, you know,
we're talking 600,000 miles on a truck that he bought brand new. I mean, shouldn't have been, you know, this is the problem with the quality of equipment these days. These new trucks, they just don't last like the old ones do.
You know, had a sizable chunk of change, and, you know, because, you know, my motto was the truck always ate first. Truck always eats first.
It's the only way to win as an owner operator.
Truck's got to, you know, the truck's got, you know, truck eats first, then you, you know. And I, you know, sizable maintenance fund, you know, it hit it pretty freaking hard, you know. I mean, I was $42,000 in 2 weeks, you know, and it was like, oh, dude, you know, that's a chunk of coin, you know, plus, you know, hotel for 3 weeks while it's getting built, you know. And then found another company, hauling utility poles. And when you hauled the utility poles, you made decent money, but you were smoking heavy every single, you were 80K every single freaking trip, you know, and they're just, you know, it's just garbage. And then, you know, the next thing you're picking up is a load of shingles out of Shafter, California, to get you back, you know, back over to pick up a load of freaking logs. And, you know, now a load of shingles, 80K. But now you're only getting $139 a mile. to the truck. And it's like, holy crap, this is not working out. Nothing seems to be, you know, and I can't stop. You know, yeah, I found, you know, something that's going to get me back into Reno on a consistent freaking basis, but I'm not making any money. I'm losing money while I'm working here. And I'm like, I am over this. So I had a buddy that I had worked with at Sherwin. He went to Walmart. I gave him a ring and I said, hey, what does Walmart require? He goes, dude, he goes, you're good. He goes, you've been driving for freaking forever. And I used to run team with the guy. So he's like, no, he goes, you're a damn good driver. He goes, fill out an application. So the application at Walmart process is pretty freaking extensive. So I've had some good background checks in my life, but their background check is no BS. And if they ask you a question, they expect an answer. And if you don't answer them, don't call back. So, you know, and they ask for stupid stuff, you know, but it's really super worth it. I think it's, you know, what they're going to do is that they're already telling me what my schedule is going to be. I haven't even gone to orientation yet. And the schedule is basically what they call a 5-2-5-3. Mm-hmm. So you work 5, off 2, work 5, off 3. But they want you back here on your 2 days off. Cool. Yes, am I going over Donner Pass every day? Yep.
How many times did you chain up that one season?
Oh, that was the winter of 1995. So 94 into 95. I threw iron 183 straight trips.
Jeez. Yeah, man. Holy shit. Not me doing it.
Yeah, that was back when, you know, they would actually stop and convoy trucks over the hill, and they just wouldn't shut it down and just say, no trucks. Well, now, you know, with today's drivers, it's, oh my God. I mean, they couldn't drive a peg in a bull's ass, most of them.
Well, there's kids on there now. There are 23-year-old kids who've lived here for six months and have been given a CDL, and they're going right over it.
Yeah. Yeah, like it's nothing. You know, and like I said, you know, my first trip over the mountain, I didn't have a Jake brake. I mean, CF didn't have freaking Jake brakes until, 98, 99, somewhere in there, when they had their big team operation, and they finally required it in the contract. Other than that, I mean, I had a speedometer, two red lights, and an air pressure gauge. There wasn't even a key in the truck. You flip the switch, you hit an air starter. That's what fired the truck up. And then you had a little air button to kill the motor. That was it. Unsynchronized 7-speed. You know, that's what I cut my teeth on.
You know, that's awesome.
Old junkie.
So I want to touch. I definitely want to get into Walmart real quick, but I definitely want to take this time to kind of recap, because, man, what a phenomenal story. And if I could just say, if this was me, man, because here's the thing. So I sometimes find myself, I'm confronted with this dilemma of, did I make the right decision getting into trucking and stuff? Because with me, I come from, you know, I have a legacy in it with my grandfather and a historic company. And in a sense, what I'm trying to do is restore a brand, because my family's company was once the identity of an entire city. When you think about it, you know, it was a place where people spent their careers and had pensions, and people in the city of Waterbury and in the region respected companies like Lombard. And like, so that's part of my mission, what I'm trying to really bring back. But with how, you know, I'm faced with this dilemma of, and I ask myself this question, and this is from The Sopranos, he says it like right in the first episode, you know, it's good to get into something at the ground floor. You know, I know that, but, you know, I feel as though I came in at the end, and sometimes I'm faced with this dilemma, like, did I come in right at the end of trucking? And who knows, that's up for debate. And I'll talk on that more. But like with you, if I had to go through what you went through, because you rolled with everything, you put so much into this industry, because number one, you got to see it from the end of, you grew up and were raised by guys who did grow up in the Lombard era of good trucking jobs. Like, these guys had good jobs, it was respected. So that's what you got to see. And then when you got into it, you came in when the Teamsters were fucking limping after deregulation, because that's what they were doing. It's like each of these companies that was closing was consolidating. They couldn't negotiate because they could not physically compete with all these major retailer companies undercutting them. So they had to cut pay. They couldn't give you jobs, and you were doing backbreaking labor, and you couldn't do this. So if that was me, I would have been like, holy shit, they're really butchering this industry. I would have fucking quit all out there together. But you kept rolling with it, kept putting into it. And then it seems as though once you can't risen to the top, something I could tell you, because that story of you telling that in 2002, to hear that gutted me. And I think people, especially for my friends who are non-drivers who listen to this, need to really truly see that, hey, this is because I grew up in the 90s, and I remember growing up very much well. I remember growing up well and seeing these trucks, and like to see that the industry in the 90s was reeling back from deregulation, but it was still, the technology and everything was still set in the 60s and 70s, but it was trying to progress past the 1980 deregulation. So the collage of who the people were was at such a clash that it was such a tough industry to really make it in, because as the unions were dying, you had so much going on. And for all this happened, I mean, to get laid off in 2002, like you did, it's crazy now. You have Google employees who are going into work and, their key cards aren't working. But to get home from vacation and to have a recording on your voicemail box, on your recording machine, that says to call an 800 number to hear that you got fired, is like probably the most gut-wrenching thing I can ever hear of. That would have freaking ripped me apart. And then even for you, I love that you really got into the nuts and bolts of your owner operator experience, because like me, I get paid a percentage of loads, but you did it per mile thing. And it's like to show, guys out there, like this is what a lot of people were doing throughout the mid 2000s, up until basically, I'd say within the last 3 or 4 years, like this is how a lot of the industry ran. And here you are to come on. Like, people need to realize, like, this is what you started in this industry as these unions were starting to deteriorate. And it's like, this is what we're witnessing, how the industry did start to deteriorate, to have guys out here like you, seasoned veterans, driving trucks and essentially making no money during some of these times. And it's a wild concept to think of. And I got to fucking tip my cap to this, because like, I don't know if I would have, my wife, I think, would have talked some sense into me, and she would have said, hey, let's make a game plan here or something. So I gotta give it to you, because that's a lot of gumption you have. You're very fortunate for the situation you're in. You didn't just fly by night. You have a good family. I mean, that's the thing. You set yourself up with a good foundation of having a good, strong family, and that helps. And hey, in the long run, it's paying off, because Walmart, and for as much hate my show gives to mega carriers, I don't consider Walmart a mega carrier. They're a large retail company. But by any stretch of the means, what Walmart has going on right now as a job for drivers is exactly how the industry should have evolved post 1980. Because how they treat their drivers, the schedule that they're on, it's a regional type gig. So you still get a little bit of that travel over there, because I pulled for Walmart trailers when I drove with Pam. And that regional gig was a lot of fun. Different schedule. You didn't get the benefits. I was still a Pam employee, so it kind of sucked. But overall, like, yeah, that 5 on, 2 off. So you'll get weekends off. You'll get your time back at home. You get to slide through the house. You still get to go out and do it. And then you're also in good equipment, and you always have access to parking. Like, the system is set up for drivers to want to spend careers there.
Exactly. Exactly. And that's what I was weighing my options between going to UPS and working in the hub and throwing boxes for probably a year, maybe 18 months. I'm 53. I'm kind of worn out. But that was, and then build enough seniority that I could get into the feeder position, because, UPS, there's another company that, it's a Teamster company, but they really pay their drivers damn well. They pay them really well, and their benefits are phenomenal. But I weighed, could I physically do that? I probably could. But that 1 year to 18 months of whatever it would be, that's only, it's like $16.50 an hour.
Yeah.
Well, now I got to find a freaking, you know, I'm going to be working two, maybe three jobs. I can go to Walmart and they're basically saying, you know, you can make up to 110 your first year. Dude, that's sold. Sign me up. Let's do it.
And it's drop and hook. That's the thing with Walmart is is primarily drop and hook. I know at least on the Pam side, like my general schedule, and I feel as though this is going to be the same, is I would go to the DC. I would check in at 5 a.m. I would and like you could almost work whatever schedule you want. At least like when it came to me, it's like I would go to the check in at the DC in New Braunfels, Texas at 5 a.m. They'd say, okay, hey, go out to section here, grab trailer 12345. That trailer is going to go to this store down here in Comfort, Texas. You're going to grab an empty. You're going to go down to Laredo. You're going to get loaded or you're going to drop and hook in Laredo. Grab this and it's going to Opelousas, Louisiana, to a distribution center there. I don't know if I pronounced that name right, but it's going to go here. And then from there, you'll check in with that distribution center and you'll get a new trip.
Yeah.
And it's just, and it was like, and the thing is I can make the, I talked to so many drivers, like one guy I was getting loaded in, cause you'll do some live loads and unloads. One driver was telling me, cause I told him, I was like, yeah, I normally try to start rolling at 4 a.m. in case I got trucks, cause they didn't let Pam drivers park at DCs, some of them. So I was like, yeah, I'd get started at 4 a.m. so I can park early and work out. And the guy's like, oh no, he was edging retirement too. And he's like, oh no, he goes, I start at 9, I'll finish at, you know, 9, 10 at night, you know, because he'll stop it at DC. Like he makes his own hours, essentially, you know. And it's good. And some people think I talked about this on the episode a couple episodes ago with Blythe about ego and trucking and with the way the models have gone is people in this industry believe that the only upward trajectory as a driver is to either be an owner operator or own a fleet or what have you. But in reality, it's just, you know, it's not for everybody. Like even, you know, you described it really well about how being west of I-35 is very tough as an owner operator, especially if you want to have a family. And it's like, hey, you, as long as you are making money in this industry and it's staying safe and evolving and going wherever, you're still winning. And it's like some people, the reason why more people haven't flocked to Walmart has been ego. In this sense, they're obsessed with this passion of being their own boss, making their own, calling their own shots. And hey, I like that too. But you know, when reality hits you, if you're not able to do it, it's okay to go back and work for a fucking badass company. Because the thing is, I mentioned these two terms, entrepreneur and intrapreneur. We need intrapreneurs. Go to a company or a carrier, help them grow. You know, be a part of their victory too, because their victories are yours.
Absolutely, absolutely. And it's, you know, it, you know, spanning the career. I mean, you know, I've driven, you know, every state in the union, every province of Canada. And it's, you know, now I'm going to be at a place where I can go, you know, go out, do my week, come back, spend it with the family, you know, and just go do it again. Just put my head down, do another 15 years, bulk my retirement up and just, you know, wash my hands of the whole thing. You know, it's not that I'm not going to love, you know, trucking. I love what I do. I absolutely love what I do. And it took me a long time to, after the LTL closure and with CF and Yellow and just, you know, kind of being crapped on. And that's, you know, that's how I felt about it. I really hated driving a truck. Absolutely despised it. But I had to learn, you know, myself that if you hate it, you're just going to be miserable in everything that you do. So why don't you start loving it? And maybe you can love yourself a little bit and maybe turn things around. And when I did that, I mean, I really excelled, just absolutely excelled. And it was just a mental thing, just an absolute mental thing. You know, but playing those mental gymnastics with yourself, you know, you can put yourself in a big rut, you know, because, you know, shit happens. And, you know, you can either dwell on it or move on and, you know, look at the big picture of, you know, your family, yourself, and take that into account and just keep on rolling.
Yeah, and taking that time, stepping back, taking accountability of the situation, and then making a move and making, because like you said, yeah, at the time you hated it when the LTL stuff was closing, but when you take a step back and take the accountability of why you started in the first place, of realizing your why, figure out now your how of how are you going to make this work, as opposed to just, because what are you going to, yeah, I mean, are you going to quit and go back to being a mechanic? How much has being a mechanic evolved since the last time you had done that? So, you know.
Yeah, no, I wasn't a real good mechanic to begin with. So, you know.
Mm-hmm. No, that's.
I'm good enough to put myself into trouble. So.
Yeah, no, I love it, man. I commend your story. So Walmart's hiring process, I just in case anybody's out there looking for a job, I'm assuming, what are their requirements, and what does the, like, say, preach it to me. Say I sold my truck tomorrow. I want to work at Walmart. What is required of me? What do I need to do? And what are the
basically, a super clean driving record. The least amount of CSA points, I mean, like zero, is like a really, really big contributor. I believe they've lowered, I'm not sure how many years of experience that you need, but I believe it's 18 months. I believe it's an 18 month thing. You can also get your license through Walmart too. So you can go to work for one of the stores, or you could go to work for one of the DSCs or whatever, and basically just tell them, hey, I want to be a driver. And they'll put you through freaking school. They'll pay for it to, you know, and you can make, you know, pretty damn good money doing it. And they pay you to go to school. So that's another crazy thing. You know, they're trying to encompass, you know, get everybody to do it. But yeah, just a super clean record, you know, I believe it's 18 months. Don't try not to quote me on that, but, and then, you know, no accidents, no felonies, no DUIs, no, you know, you just, you know, they want, and like I said, their background that they do is,
I was gonna say, go into that. Yeah.
Background that they do is extensive. It is absolutely extensive. And they will send you a copy of it. But first time that's ever happened to me. I've had backgrounds run, you know, I got secret clearance, for Christ's sakes. Mm-hmm. I never got, you know, they never sent me a PDF and saying, hey, this is what it looked like, you know. They're going to pull your MVR, you know, for your history, for the entire history that you've been driving. They're going to pull the MVR. They want to see it. Like I said, the background's extensive, and you have to, if they ask you a question, respond. You need to give them the answer, even though it may be something completely stupid. You know, they want the response, because if you don't respond to them, you're not going to get another response.
It's just like it's like a smell test.
Yeah, exactly. Now, and you know,
go on.
Oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, do they hair test?
I don't know if they do or not, but I know they're going to, once I get to orientation in Red Bluff, they do a DOT talk screen right there.
Yeah, regular one. Yeah, because it's just something I find weird, because at one point, major carriers were like lobbying, the mega carriers, probably not Walmart, were lobbying to the FMCSA to like mandate hair tests, like be the standard. Yeah. For toxicology shit, and they were pushing for that. And I think the reason, and the thing is that fits into the ATA's agenda of making trucking this meat grinder, because hair tests, now you're not testing for use, you're testing for lifestyle. And at that point, you're just adding to the turnover, because somebody with long hair could have smoked weed 2 years ago and it's still in their hair. And it's like,
I live in Nevada, and I smell skunk bud across the street from me all the time. So yeah. I think it's just a regular old urinalysis, you know. Yeah.
No, it's but good. Yeah. If you're just not a shithead, Walmart works.
That's pretty much it. You know, and you know, yeah, it, you know, I've talked with my buddy that works there, and he's like, listen, they do have cameras. He goes, but there's none facing you anymore.
It's dash cams.
Yeah, it's a dash cam. you know, basically, you know, if there's a stop sign, dude, stop, you know, don't Hollywood it, you know, you know, just keep your following distance. I mean, just that simple, you know, trucking 101, man, you know, don't scratch it, bend it, or break it because it ain't yours. You know, that's just don't do that.
Yeah, no, it's pretty easy going. The cameras they use, I'm similar. They have them over here at Warren. Essentially, yeah, don't ride up on anybody. Stop at the stop sign. Because, yeah, if you do that, they'll ding it to you. Yeah, don't speed. And it's like, and I haven't gotten – I've gotten two messages about speeding, but it's because, you know, sometimes on these country roads and you're heavy and you're OD – like I don't like I'm not I'm sorry, but I'm not gonna like when it goes from 65 to 40, I'm gonna use the engine. I'm gonna use the Jake. You know, I'm not. And it's, you know, sometimes I'll be 10 over by the time I get there. So
yeah, it's gonna take a while. It just is.
Yeah. No, dude, this is awesome. I'm really happy that you're getting yourself to Walmart because you're now in the twilight of your career. This is when you should be enjoying it. This is when you need to be taking a step back. Like, you shouldn't be throwing packages at UPS. Although I know UPS is good. When I was working at a warehouse, I met a UPS driver. He drove and delivered on the last day he was at work. He talked about his retirement pension. He was ecstatic. He loved his career. It was awesome. So UPS isn't bad. But yeah, man, at this point in time, like, dude, this is the job you want. What's crazy is I couldn't say it enough. Like, everything that you saw from like what Walmart's doing is the 21st century, what should have happened post deregulation. Instead, it became this race to the bottom and became just this absolute, you know, meat grinder of a system that is just a churn and burn, where to the point in which we even have major companies like Prime pitching to new drivers to become lease operators. Like, just this idea of lease purchase stuff at large companies where you're competing with company drivers for freight. Like, what are we doing? Like, that's how low they're trying to drop wages. And it's like, for you to see that, like, for you to see the golden age and like in every experience to, and then to basically see the deepest of the valleys, you're coming out on top with Walmart. But I know we're running a little bit on time, but you see, you've been down Donner Pass with no Jakes. You've been to every U.S. state. You've been to every Canadian province. What's some of the, you know, what's some of the craziest shit out there you've seen? Some wild stuff. You can leave the names out.
Oh, dude. I mean, so Donner Pass. And I mean, I, you know, just horror stories of dropping off of there, off of every hill there has a name. There's airport. There's 3 Mile. I mean, you know, there's the steps that you got to come off of. There's King Vale. I think every single one of those, I've seen a truck on fire off the freaking side of the road, wadded up in the trees. Somebody freaking, you know, just passed on because, you know, they just didn't do it right. You know, and that's back in the older days. But yeah, I mean, you know, if there was a mountain pass around, I would always go to it. Like, you know, go over to Wolf Creek Pass, dude, you know, just to enjoy the beauty of it. And that's the thing I love about the job, is because that next turn in the road could be the most spectacular thing you've seen in your entire life, you know. And that's what I've always just, I live for it.
Oh, dude, absolutely. It's addicting. Yeah. That's why some people leave and they have to come back, man. It's like, there is some, you know, it's why my dad rides motorcycles. It's why, you know, people do certain things they do. Like, there's so many guys on YouTube who have channels and, you know, they'll leave. They'll be like, yeah, I'm quitting. I'm getting this. And then 6 months later, that, you know, they're dragged back in.
Oh, they are. They absolutely are. But no, I mean, funny story. I was working for, at the time, I was in between CF and Yellow, and I had taken the job at Conway, and I was up on the pass, blizzard, just an absolute, you know, getting with it. And I'm all chained up. Everything's, you know, and I'm dropping off the hill, basically zero visibility. I look down and my phone is ringing and I'm like, man, what the hell? Shoot. And it's my wife. And I'm like, man, it's like 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, holy shit, what's going on? So I answer the phone and I'm like, hey, babe, I said, what's going on? She goes, there's a mouse. And I just looked around. I'm like, are you freaking kidding me? Are you freaking kidding me? I'm in just horrible freaking conditions right now. You know, I'm just, you know, I'm fighting it because I can't see the road. I have no clue. They closed it right behind me. Just dumping and dumping and dumping. And what, there's a mouse? What the frick are you talking about? She's like, she goes, what do I do? And I'm like, nothing. Go back to sleep. I was like, come on, babe. You know, that just cracked me up. I was like, there's no freaking way. I'm in a goddamn blizzard and you're calling me because there's a mouse?
Oh, yeah. The level of disconnect between the driver and non-driver out there. They're like, oh, my God, this is going on. And it's like, oh, well. Yeah, and they have no idea the day you went through. No, that's awesome. So nothing crazy. You never saw any crazy, no drug deals, no prostitutes killing anybody.
I've had door knockers all over the freaking everywhere. You know, you'd come walking out of a truck stop. Hey, baby, you want a date? You know, the old Steel City truck stop. You know, in there in Gary, Indiana.
Take a bath in that. The potholes there, you could take a bath back in the day.
You know,
was a sketchy place.
Yeah, you go in the back row.
For anybody that's not been around forever, you know, that's the Petro now. It's the Petro. The current Petro at Gary, Indiana is the old Steel City. That place was rough.
That was one of the roughest places. That was the first time I'd ever have somebody. And dude had a trench coat on. Opened his trench coat and he had watches and sunglasses. And I'm like,
businessman,
just go, man, just go away. You know?
Oh yeah. I ignorantly stayed at the Petro in Gary, Indiana once too, where they have roving 24-hour security. And I actually did like a workout in front of my truck there with like a kettlebell and my jump rope. And the security guy was looking at me like I was a fucking moron. Like he was like, what is this kid doing? You can hear the gunfire going on like in the area. And I was like, the parking lot's well lit. There's a security guy. Let me get a quick 30 minutes in. Yeah. And the security guy's looking at me like, who is this?
Yeah. Sleeping in the truck in Compton, California, and having LAPD pull up and say, hey, is everything okay? Oh yeah. Everything's fine, man. I'm just going to go to bed here. And he goes, you probably want to not. He goes, we'll be back by. I said, hey, dude, I can't move. I'm out of hours. You know, and that's back when the first e-logs started coming out. And he's like, well, he goes, we'll come by every 30 minutes and check on you and make sure you're still living. Oh, okay. And all I heard all night was freaking gunfire.
Yeah. And that's it. That's what that's how it is. There's parts that are still like that. I mean, I was faced with that too. We would do this turn and burn where I would drop off in Ontario, California, but I'd have to go all the way across LA to by the Port of Long Beach. I believe it's Carson, California, which is right next to Compton. I'd pick up from there and that would go back to like Oklahoma City or something. But if I wasn't out of that warehouse by 3 p.m., you're screwed. So I would cheat. And, you know, I would put myself on PC just to get back to the TA in Ontario. Because there's absolutely nowhere safe at all to park in that area. You know, you're fucked if you stay around there. But so one last question before we sign off. If I was a brand new driver, you know, you're a seasoned veteran in this game. Two questions. No, if you're a seasoned veteran in this game, if I was a new driver, What route would you tell them to go? Like where, you know, besides Walmart, is there a certain career path you would direct guys to go to, or maybe you got any other companies you want to give a shout out to?
Well, there's two answers to it. Because there's always the LTL game, and the LTL game, you're still driving a truck, but you're going to be home every night. And then you have to look at what kind of lifestyle you want to live. And there's, you know, a lot of people knock mega carriers, But there's actually, and there's been a lot of, you know, a lot of good things that have, you know, progressed in some of those mega carriers. You're probably going to want to just do your time with that and then, you know, work your way into, you know, whatever niche you want to be in. I mean, there's all kinds of niches in trucking. And, you know, and if you have a particular itch, go scratch it. Go do it.
Yeah. Now, that's another thing that's key too. I think I'm glad you brought that up. It's like people think trucking is a one size fits all game. It's absolutely not. Like, you know, Chris, you love doing the pneumatic stuff. Like, you're all about it. There's people who love doing flatbed. There's people who want to just bump docks. There's people who want to move, you know, overdimensional stuff. Like, you have to find your niche. There's people who love reefer. I don't know why they love doing reefer, because I wouldn't be able to stand the appointment times. And then, yeah, because it's region specific. There's a company I was actually going to, you know, I had him on the show. His name's Jesse. He worked for a company called Central Oregon Truck Lines. Might have been a company, you know, if you known about, they would have loved to nab a guy like you up. They're in the Western 11 quite often. They're based out of Oregon, and they could have had you home weekly or something running flatbed. You're still throwing a lot of tarps, and personally, maybe you're past the days of throwing a bunch of tarps, but like, you got to find the right company. But yeah, some of them, like TMC, TMC, from what I see, I've talked to so many TMC drivers. They seem to be a very good flatbed company who has made really good decisions. Their pay scale is good. Whatever you've got going on, they'll kind of build something around you if you want to be home weekly, regional, or something. So they're good too. But yeah, I think that's the best way to word it, is finding your niche. Do you want to do LTL? Do you want to go over the road? And then I guess the next question is, are the roles going to switch now? Chris got you to Autumn. Are you going to drag him over to Walmart now?
Well, he wants a report card.
I always get a report card everywhere he goes.
So okay. If the report card looks good,
as far as being an owner operator, my position, it's as good as it's going to get. It's not going to get much better.
Unless you add a truck, get your own DOT.
Yeah. Unless I, you know, get into the new truck game. And I, you know, sometimes I want that, sometimes I don't. You know, we'll get into my story on the next podcast whenever we get that. We'll do the full thing there. But, you know, I've been with Autumn for 13 years. My numbers are solid. I live in a good area in the country where I can get a pretty decent amount of home time. So there's not a lot of reason for me to change. But I'm also only 41 years old, and you know, I've got at least 29 more years of trucking in me, if not longer. So, you know, I don't know what the long game is right now. Currently, I'm not, you know, not thinking about leaving. But I'm also an opportunity guy. So,
yeah,
you know,
if it jumps at you, yeah. If there's
it makes a better lifestyle sense, then yeah. I mean, Walmart's a perfect company. And then, you know, as my part, if you're a new driver, wherever you go, go there with the plan of sticking there at least a year, if not two. I always tell guys, 2 years, same company, zero wrecks. Don't sign a lease purchase. Do those things. And usually, you know, I've always made good money in trucking. You can always do it. Sometimes you got to do things you don't really want to do, but you know, you can make a good living and life out of career out of trucking.
Yeah. It's still there. It is still a good career for anyone, and for anyone who wants it. It's just, as opposed to pre 1980, it's harder to find. You do it, you know, because in pre 1980, you pretty much had two options. Either you're going to the union, or you were an independent kind of outlaw wildcatter, and both of those were good options and very lucrative. And for the outlaw, for those outlaw guys, the non-union guys pre 1980, they were still their own boss kind of the way. There wasn't as much like corruption as it was. I mean, these guys ran by a code, and so you only had those two options, and it was really regionally specific. But now, to find the good in a trucking career, you've got to read between the weeds, and you've got to meet the right people. You've got to network. You got to talk. I mean, there's so much. You got to find it, and then you got to also make sure you keep your record clean enough to get it.
Absolutely.
Yep.
But yeah. No. Hey, Dave, I want to thank you for coming on the show. That's an awesome story, man. Like I said, I give you a lot of credit. Like I said, I don't know if I could have if I would have had the same level of mental headspace to persevere the same way you have. So I got to give it to you. You don't have any sort of social media So you know, anybody listening can't really find you, but if they see you driving out there in the Western 11 in a Walmart truck, I guess they'll have to give you the honk.
Absolutely. Wave with all your fingers.
Yeah, wave with all of them. And for you guys listening, thanks. If you made it this far, you know where to find me anywhere. At Lombard Trucking, reach out. And we're going to have Chris, the Indy Trucker, on very, very soon once we get a schedule going. And with that, we will see you all in the next one. Take care.
See ya.
Thanks.